Hello again. Today I wanted to talk about procrastination. I read it a little while back. I think a friend of mine had kind of posted it up on Facebook, and he was something about the feeling of procrastination. So I thought that was an interesting topic. I think what I re in a sense what I want to try and fold it into is a discussion about my day. It's all about me. I'm kidding. No, but one of the comments I've had for a while, or in the past, I'm sorry, people have asked, how do you do so much stuff? How do you do so much work? You always get the comment, man, you must never sleep. Actually, I do sleep. I didn't when I was younger. I know that, and sort of never a good route to go when it comes to not sleeping and doing this kind of work. And, with the animation, with everything else, the difficulty you have is your creativity. Ultimately, to be able to create, I believe, to be able to create and to be able to create in the way that I think that you need to, I think it requires a fresh mind and all that. So, not sleeping, I think, can make you very productive from a production standpoint. In other words, if you're managing rote tasks like, hitting the, running a certain set of orchestrated commands, then I think that's possible, and you can do it for a long time until you fall asleep. But being creative is very difficult. So anyway, sorry, little segue about sleeping. I remember when I was younger, I saw this magazine and said, and I started my career doing 3D animation, and I saw this article that was talking about Lightwave. That's the software package that I use. I use NewTek Lightwave, and it said, "Real, because real Lightwavers never sleep." And so I thought, oh yeah, I'm never gonna sleep. And anyway, bad idea. But moving back to procrastination, or more to my current point, is creating. In a way, I think I allow my mind to just overflow with ideas, and then I try and what I do is I write these little things I call idea sheets, and these things take down these ideas. I mean, I guess anybody would just call them notes. So I'll have them on my phone, and they'll kind of upload through that Apple Share deal, and then I'll have all that information available to me, when I get home or the internet or whatever. And so that allows me to track down the ideas that I have at the time, and therefore when I can then expand upon them. And so sometimes one of the mistakes I used to make is that I had this idea, and then I would sort of fixate on that idea, and when I got home or whatever it was, that would be the only, and I would just kind of block out every other idea. And the problem that I found doing that is that sometimes the ideas run their course, and now you start getting creative, but you lose track of your original idea because you're just kind of flowing. So what I'll do is I'll have an idea, I'll kind of jot it down, then I just kind of leave it. And if I have a couple of other ideas, I'll jot them down and leave it until those ideas grow, and get a little bit longer. And that way, I have a more defined path, a little bit longer. So patience. But back to procrastination is that even in that, even when you're growing all these ideas and doing these things and writing the way that I do and what have you, or drawing in the way that I do, coming up with these character designs or whatever in the world it is I'm gonna do, you have those moments. I still do, and it's like, oh great, I have to turn this into a screenplay, and then now you're like, I gotta start the whole process again, fade out or fade in, and interior, elevator, lab, day, this girl, and then you have to hit start all over again. In my mind, I know this character. Her name is, I don't know, Ashley. And, but now after the whole process of this girl, 21, with this kind of clothing, fair skin, nice, Ashley Kendall Riley, comma, approaches the, and so that dread of having to go through that again. And I have a lot of scripts I have to write. I'm still writing a ton of stuff, and so you have that when it comes down to music. I have this great theme in my mind, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh man, I gotta plug this in, and I've gotta open GarageBand, and I've gotta, and there's no beat, and I've gotta make a beat, and then I start thinking about everything beyond that. I'm like, oh man, I gotta make these drums and the bass and blah blah, what's it gonna sound like? And I think those thoughts can be overwhelming. I know they can. Every facet of my life has that. So I think procrastination exists regardless of how creative you are, or regardless of how productive you can be. It's still that. This is called that devil that's back there that's waiting to get on you and say, oh man, you'll never finish this. And the way that I've managed to navigate that, or in a sense, I don't know if necessarily I'm like the champion of procrastination because I still do it, is by breaking everything down little by little by little. I use Photoshop as an example. When I first began my career at Human Code in Austin, Texas. Human Code! So when I first began my career at Human Code, I remember that, I didn't know any software at all whatsoever. And I remember I sat down and I had opened Photoshop, or David, my cousin David, opened Photoshop for me. And I was supposed to sit down and create this interface. Not that I even knew what that was, but it was what I was supposed to do. So he opens Photoshop for me, and he's just trying to open a new document. While he's doing this, I keep seeing these dialogue panels, or I'm not sure what they call them, but these panels are opening up, and every panel has a subpanel, and all these things are these subsets, and I'm going like, oh my gosh, what did I get myself into? This thing is just huge. And then if you look at any other software program like Flash, the one I used to draw, if you look at, especially with the 3D programs, and some of them can just get downright crazy, like Maya can just get nuts, where you're open and there's just menus upon menus upon menus, and then there's buttons and there's fields and you can type on this information, and you just want to quit. I just want to quit. You just want to hit a reset button and let me just stop. But what I do is I just try to break it down. Now, I've had to do that because I have to. I mean, I was at that job, Human Code, and David had me there, and I certainly didn't want to embarrass him by, his peers coming over and me sitting there with a blank page. I sort of had to, like, go through and say, okay, new file. Makes a new file. Okay, here's a paintbrush. And then I had really great friends. Homer was there, and I don't remember if I called him my first day. But I know ever since then, I'm like, Homer, I need help figuring this out. And he would come over, and we actually learned keyboard shortcuts together. We would go on the little keyboard, and we would just press buttons and see what would happen in Photoshop. And it was fun. We would do that. We were in these cubicles, and we'd sort of call back and forth over the cubicles. These commands to each other. Okay, Alt, N, Shift, 3. Open up a paintbrush window, and so that's how we learn keyboard commands to make our. It makes you're doing the same thing, but it makes it easier. But back to breaking it down one thing at a time. I think that's for me that's what I've always been able to do, or what I've tried to do, strive to do. Focus on one thing, small thing, and don't sweat the big stuff. Or I guess in a sense, don't sweat the small stuff. I think that's probably better. Which, in a sense, says not looking at the big picture, because the big picture can be daunting, it can seem impossible, and like I said, overwhelming. And so, the details are going to be there, that's fine. All these things are going to happen, that's fine. But if you focus on the one small thing, it's like writing a book, or writing a novel, or writing a screenplay, or making a song, or a symphony, or whatever. I mean, you can think about all the parts and pieces that come to it, but what's the reason that you're there? There's always something that brings you there, and that's when you try and focus on a small thing. You know, if you're there because you're playing music, and it's like chances are you have the ability to play at that instrument. I mean, you may not fully be able to, envision the entire process of making an album with backup singers and accompanying guitar and drums and sweetening the music and the mix and the whole bit, but you likely have some idea how to play an instrument. And so from that, those are the things to hold on to. Those are the small things to hold on to, is that there's a reason that you're there, and do that one thing. And I think when you do that, all the other things start coming into place. Once you have something basic, like a musical track, and you have your guitar track, and you've laid it down, in many cases, who knows? Maybe you don't know the drums, maybe you don't know all these other parts, but you can probably find people to come through, and now that you have at least something there, Which brings up another sort of topic of discouragement. It's very easy to get discouraged, which is sort of the main, let's just call that demon's other brother, is discouragement that comes along. And even when you start something that you've been dreading or procrastinating over, wants to come through and say, oh man, this sounds terrible, this is bad, this is going to be bad, you should stop, you should do something else, this is not good. You know, it's just brush that brother aside, because ultimately you're doing something, right? You're moving forward and you're doing something. Now, this is in reference to creativity. I know people have other things in their lives that maybe aren't so grand or pressing that just don't feel like doing. And so that's a life lesson, but for me, I still approach it the same way. I might get up, for me right now, I'm taking the bus everywhere, and so that's a whole ordeal. I mean, you got to get up, you got to go out there to the bus stop, you got to get on the bus. It takes you like 2 hours to get anywhere, and so easily it's just like, you know what, I don't need to do that, and you know, I don't want to do this either, because it's two hours there, 2 hours back. You're talking about 4 or 5 hours to go somewhere for maybe 5 minutes. And it's like, oh man, I don't want to do that. But again, it's just, okay, don't think about the whole process. Just get up and do what the one small thing you need to do. And then get outside and then get over there. Okay, now you're there. And then when, at least for me, since I've done that process enough, once I get going, I'm like, okay, cool, it's fine. But it's hard to make that first step. And that first step, generally, like I said, I just try and lower it down to the lowest common denominator. Minimize it if I can, and that's the easiest step to take. So for me and procrastination, that's what I will say. Now, on to other things. I've sort of come up with a plan of what I want to do. I've written all these screenplays, and I have so many more to write. Good Lord. In the small brief amount of time, I think I've written Zombie 17. I wrote a web series that I was going to try and do for that called Zombie 17 Origin. It's this real short thing, and more like a demo. It's really just a demo that I put a little dialogue into. Normally what I do with a demo or a proof of concept is I'll just take like maybe 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes of a movie and then try and film it. In this case, what I thought I would try and do is film something like an episode or something. And so I wrote this other event that would allow me to show the same clothing and the same cinematography and all the other things that would be in the movie, but in a way that I could then leverage for other media. So I did that, Zombie 17 Origin. Also rewrote like nearly a page one rewrite on a D7 Peacemaker Nightfall, which is another interesting topic. But I did that, and that was about 2 hours and some change, about 2 hours, five, 2 hours, 10 minutes. I'm right at this point, I'm about 75-80% of the way through Midnight Clear 2. That I've written. I've also, what else have I done? Anyway, I can't even remember. I've written so much stuff, but I have a ton of scripts left to write, and so a ton of that left to go. But I'm taking a day off today. Today I'm taking a day off. I think it's the first kind of sort of day off I've had in a long time. So I'm gonna do something that's not writing, which is probably why I'm recording. But I've also been editing this project that I worked on in Dallas at the same time doing all of this, and then all the character designs for D7 Peacemaker. So I'm taking a day off. But in that whole process of doing that, one thing I was searching for, and I think I talked about this last time, but the one thing I was searching for was the next project I was going to work on. And so right now, as of this moment, my idea, and it could change. Good. But my idea as of this moment is Blackout. I finally, after 3 years of failure, have come up with an idea for Blackout, and it has very little to do with the original concept at all. But it's a psychological horror film that would be completely different than anything else I've ever made. Really for the fact that the movie in itself is gonna be dark, and I'm gonna take this character and beat her down throughout the whole film. Which is, you know, for me, that's never fun. It's probably why I don't watch those kind of... I mean, I do watch horror films. It's just not like... I've never been like a huge horror fan. And that's probably why. I mean, I don't like watching these tragedies where the bad guy wins, which is ultimately the point of a horror film. I mean, you take good people who've really done nothing wrong. Or, you know, you have stupid films. Or maybe not stupid films. But you have films where they have done something wrong. And they deserve it. But in most cases, you have people who've done maybe not a lot wrong. And suddenly they're going to get just terrorized and tortured and then destroyed. And so that's my challenge here is it's never been my kind of film. The problem is with all the blackout failure, the scripts, the failures is because of that. I've always turned them into these less of a horror and more of a thriller. I'm trying to make this a horror film. I don't know if I'll succeed. I'm not really too concerned about that. I really don't care if it's the most terrifying film in the world. I do want it to be a good film. And a good film that I can make with literally no money. And that's going to be a challenge, but I love challenges. I do. So Blackout, I'm writing the script now of a treatment, or I have an idea of a treatment, but I'm going to write that script now. Hopefully I can shoot that or start pulling things together to shoot that. I think it'll be pretty exciting from what it is, because I got a pretty good idea. Andy Arrowsmith and I have discussed the whole thing, and, you know, over the years. Has it been so long? But we've discussed this thing over the years and come up with what I think is a pretty solid idea. And so I'm going to try and flesh that thing out and see if I can film this. So all my actors out there, all my people out there, keep on the keep your heads on a swivel, because I'll be looking out and seeing what I can get there. So Blackout, thing I want to work on. But back to D7 Peacemaker Nightfall real quick, just real briefly, and then I'll end this whole blah blah session. Nightfall is interesting. I wrote Nightfall, page one, and I came to this sort of realization, if you will, that you know, I was ready to animate. I was ready to do the whole thing. I put together actually an animatic for it, and I was getting ready to do all the stuff. But then I really took a look back at that. I'm sorry, and you know, I was like, you know, this is good. This is good. It's entertaining. I feel confident that I can write something and create something that's going to be entertaining. But unfortunately, in the stage that I'm in, it can't be good. It has to be great. And so I had to then look at it again and say, well, is this great? Is this a great movie? And D7 Peacemaker itself is meant to be a trilogy. I wrote back in 2001. It was D7 Peacemaker Prodigal Child, D7 Peacemaker Weapon Next, and D7 Peacemaker Final Protocol. I was talking to a buddy of mine, and I brought up this, you know, the notion, and early on, D7 Peacemaker Prodigal Child was the first script I ever wrote, period, the end, period, ever. My buddy Ed Viator up in Dallas was mentoring me on how to write a script. I mean, I had literally no clue. I didn't even know what screenplay was. And I wrote this thing, and immediately when I was finished, we had the opportunity to get in touch, or to be contacted by 20th Century Fox, who then read the script, who was looking at the script. So early on, that was my induction to screenwriting, which is to say that I already knew, it was already implanted in me, this thing it wasn't about being good, it was about being great, because you're competing with literal feature films. I mean, it was this one opportunity I had. Fortunately, I've had many, many, many other opportunities in the after that, and you would say, well, you're living in your room with these little posters up on the wall, so there's a lot of opportunities, and you know, I'm blessed, I thank God for that, for those opportunities. I don't know if I would say I didn't make the most of them, or they were just great, you know, blessings that were able to just kind of keep me in line, that it's not impossible, because it feels impossible. You're writing a script and you're trying to make a movie and you're like, where is this going? And am I going to make these movies that cost nothing or forever? And what am I doing? And you remember those moments. And I remember those times that we've had, the meetings we've had with studios and Universal Studios, and been on the lot, or Tony's been on the lot. He's the one who goes to meetings, but you know, those moments, and you think, okay, been there, got the experience to do that, but it instills in your mind, this has to be great, more than just a TV show, more than just whatever, and that's not to say that I'm a great writer or a great creator, it's just I have to hold this standard, whatever that standard is, personally, I have to hold that standard. And so with Nightfall, I felt it was good, I didn't know it was great. I think there's a lot of good stuff there, but it's a prequel. It was never really meant to be part of the trilogy. And it's weird because it then gave me, or made me, have a stark look at the trilogy that I'd written, something I've been developing forever, sort of my flagship production, if you will, for all the people who have bought our DVDs and have the posters and all of our stuff can attest to. D7 Peacemaker's undergone a lot of changes, and you know, there's a huge thing there. There's so much stuff. And our company, I mean, the name of it is D7 Studios. And so there's a lot of history in that. And I had to look at that and go, man, is this movie any good? The trilogy. I believe it is, and I believe that it is great. I do have to really overhaul what I've done in the past, and I understand that. But that's what I came to. You know, these little the series and things that I wanted to do and all the little products that I've made, I've really come to the conclusion that unless I'm going to go all the way and make an entire story, and that story is a great story, there's really no point in me piddle-palling around with something unless it is the whole thing, because it's what I'm going up against. I mean, that's, and I'm talking about YouTube, I'm talking about these little things, that's the people I'm competing with, the people who are going all out. This is their best idea, it's their only idea. For me, the struggle is, of course, everything I write, and, you know, I don't want to play the blame game here, but I mean, I began with movie studios. And so when you do that, it's this idea that anything you make, you write, anything you create will be made, you know, and that's what you're trying to convince them. Give me this money to make this dream. And so it's very hard for me, very challenging to whittle that down to say, okay, I got one guy in a room and he's got a gun and he can't leave the room. You know, where is my film? And I mean, I can write that, but for me personally, it feels, you know, it's a little disappointing because it's like, man, I want a car chase. I want this. I want blood. I want explosions. I want something exciting to happen beyond just someone hanging out in a room. And so that's been challenging because people make great scripts from that. There's a movie, a film called Devil, and it's about these people that are stuck in hell. It was an incredible film. Phone Booth with Colin Colin Farrell? Is it? No, it's not Colin Farrell. Anyway, I can't remember which one was the comedian right now, but great movies are made like that. So that's not to say great movies. And really, that's the point of a weakness of mine, is my inability to do that. So that's what I'm trying to do. That's what I'm struggling to do. And that's what I'm hoping to do with Blackout, is make a film on a very low budget, that's very low key, that's really only involving a small group of people, and see if I can make it good. I'm crossing my fingers. And this thing then reflects into the large, huge other movies that I'm writing and making that are exciting and have all the stuff in them, but that are pricey. And so one thing will leapfrog you to the other. So kind of crossing my fingers, taking my day off, and going to play me some World of Warcraft. That's one of the things I like to do. I have my characters, and I get to put them as like little uniforms, and then I get to go and do stuff like go into the LFR. It's called Looking for Raids. It allows people to just kind of get involved and play the game without having to sort of dedicate to all this other stuff. And it's funny because in World of Warcraft, you'll see a lot of people complaining about, you know, LFR sucks, and a bunch of people who can't play the game are in there, and you know, I don't know about all that, but it's the way that I play the game. So Blizzard, if you're listening, thank you. It's the only way I can play the game. So I'm gonna play a little while. I'm gonna have myself a good time. Probably gonna catch a couple of in my room. Probably gonna watch a couple of South Korean films, some of my favorite films. I've got some really great ideas, and this goes back to how I started. That's also what I'm doing, though. I have some great ideas for Blackout, for these things, and I want to allow them to just build. And so I don't want to attack them right now. I want to let them just build. Blackout, I came up with last night, and I didn't come up with the idea. There's actually 40 pages of a script that's already written. It's just I want to let all the sort of come to me and build on that before I just go attack it again, especially considering the history. So anyways, that's what I had to say today. Hopefully something I said is going to be helpful. And thanks for listening, and I'll come to something more interesting to talk about next time. So, thanks, guys. Hook up.